In the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord. Let the church say amen,
amen.
And amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Thank you, Lord. First of all, I just want to share some books that I have with me. Go ahead and play. Amen. I want to share some books that I have with me. Tonight we're talking about sexual temptation. And I really do wish, Pastor, that all those men that were here on last night were here on tonight. Because the stuff that we really need to talk about is tonight. But it starts in the mind. But those who heard what they heard on last night and only partook in that part will only receive the first part of their deliverance. And even from standing where we are and sitting where we are, we can see that there were many men out there who needed to hear exactly what we needed to say, because they're battling.
Jesus.
And a man in here that's not battling with something. Don't care how good your suit look or how well you got your hair cut or how nice your glasses are. You're in a battle. You're in a war. We come to minister while you're on the battlefield and let you know that it is possible to win this battle, no matter how hard it might seem to be right now. I have three books, one of which really stands out for me, because I saw the program that Pastor had made up, and it was Every Man's Battle.
Amen.
Now, why has the apostle got a copy of Every Man's Battle? Because it's every man's battle.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. The devil does not care about your title. He does not care about your religious affiliation. He does not care how many suits you have in your closet. He does not care how many bishops you hang out with. It's every, including the preachers. No matter how much we may sit up here and look deep and act like we ain't got nothing going on with us, it's every. I recommend that you buy this book. And it's got a little study guide with it as well. There's another book that I read. Why he got to read books like that, you're about to find out. Because a lot of folks won't admit that they need to read stuff like this. And this is the reason that the church is in the shape that it's in today. Amen. Because we won't come clean. How you doing, Doc? God bless you, son. Bless you. Amen. You know you want to go somewhere in a corner and sit down and cry. You know you want to grab that brother's hand and say, brother, I need some help. But the system has taught us to be phony. Can't tell nobody what I'm going through. Pure Desire by Ted Roberts. Very good book. And this is a very, very awesome, awesome book. It's called Breaking the Silence.
Amen.
Breaking the Silence is by a Seventh-day Adventist pastor by the name of Bernie Anderson. And he talks about some things that we don't like to talk about, and what he went through. And he knew when he wrote this book, Pastor, that once he wrote this book, he might not never have a ministry again. Somebody might not want to hear him preach anymore. But it takes a lot of courage to come out and say, I'm a man with a battle. I'm a man in a battle. So I didn't come to play on tonight. I came to do something that may destroy what little ministry I got in this city, but I'm at the place where I really don't care about this title.
Amen.
I don't care who's going to like me anymore, either, because most of them don't. And I came to the conclusion, Pastor, that they're never going to let me preach in their little churches anyhow. They're never going to accept my offers of friendship. They're never going to let me into their little room. So I might as well just go ahead and tell the truth. Hallelujah. Yeah. Yeah. I want to be changed, yeah. I want to be changed.
Yeah, all right.
I want to be different than I am right now.
Yeah.
wanna be better.
Yes, yes, say that. Hallelujah.
I wanna be changed. Yeah, I wanna be changed. I wanna be different than I am right now. I wanna be better. I wanna be changed. Today I realize, yeah, that I cannot stay the same. Time is running out, and God's will still remains. The day is gonna finally come when we all will stand in that holy place. But only the ones who are pure in heart,
yes,
will get to see his face. So I wanna be changed, yeah. I wanna be different than I am right now. I wanna be better. I wanna be changed, yeah. I wanna be changed, Jesus. I wanna be different than I am right now. Chapter number 6. In a minute you're going to find out why I sang that, and I could not sing anything else. Change, yeah, yeah. Change. Right. I want to be. All the men look at each other and say, I want to be changed.
I want to be changed.
Anybody who does not want to be changed, you got something wrong with you. Because in our religious society, we are saturated, inundated, and surrounded by men who think they ain't got nothing wrong with them.
Amen.
But I want to be changed.
Amen.
Matthew chapter number 6 verse 22 says this. The light of the body is the eye.
All right.
And therefore thine eye be single, focused, determined. Thy whole body shall be full of light.
Jesus.
But if thine eye be evil,
all right,
thy whole body shall be full of darkness. If thine eye be evil,
Jesus,
everything about you
is evil.
It don't matter how much college you got. If thine eye be evil,
yes.
You ever see erudite, upright, educated fellas? Look how good they know where the soup spoon go, and amen. But they can't keep their zipper up. If thine eye be evil,
yeah.
Thy whole body,
the whole thing,
shall be full of darkness.
Yeah.
If therefore the light that is in thee be darkness, how great is that darkness? How all-encompassing is that darkness? That darkness, you can't hide that darkness in a corner.
Yeah.
It affects everything. It affects your wife. It affects your children. It affects your life. It affects everything. I know you think you're hiding it.
Yeah.
Jesus.
But I can see it on your face.
Tell it, Doc.
Come on.
And if I come in here wrong, you'll be able to see it on mine.
That's right.
If therefore the light is in you be darkness, how great is that darkness? No man can serve two masters.
No man.
For either he will hate the one and love the other.
Yes.
or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. He cannot serve God and mammon. And in this instance, Jesus was talking about money.
Yeah.
Amen. But essentially, he was talking about any work of the flesh that overtakes you to the point where it takes away your focus from God. Anything that stands up in your life and tries to be God, Jesus says, you can't serve that and him at the same time.
Amen.
I don't care how much religion you think you got, how much you can do the jazz, and you can jerk the jerk, and you've been a deacon, but you've been a deacon for 20 years, and nobody better not come into church and sit in your seat. You cannot serve God.
Amen. Say that.
The flesh. Here's the answer. James chapter 5.
Come on.
Don't you love those ones where you just don't know where you're going?
Amen.
You have it all laid out in your head before you get there, and then when you get there, it's like, whoop, total blank. It's got to be all you, Lord, because I just don't know. But minister to the men tonight.
Amen.
Because, you know, I got a feeling when I came in here on last night, I had the feeling that there were some real men.
Yeah.
And I told Elder Beal on the phone at lunchtime today that there were some real men there, some folk that really wanted to hear something real, not a bunch of pompous preachers sitting up looking important. Amen. But some brothers that really wanted to get free.
All right.
Amen. We might not have titles. We might not have gold chains. You know,
come on in.
Amen. I was in my spiritual father's church, and he was making jokes because I had my chain across my tie that day. He was making jokes about, because there was a bishop there. He's like, yeah, he's a real bishop. You know, so he got these fake chains across. You know, you know what the Lord said to me? He said, it's all right to chain fake. As long as the man real. There's a whole lot of them got solid gold, got the real stuff, just as fake as they want to be.
You know that,
man. They don't care about nobody but themselves. But they got the gold.
Go on.
James 5 and 16.
Go ahead.
I want all the men to read this with me.
Amen.
What does it say?
Confess your faults one to another and pray for one another.
Yeah.
That she may be healed.
Mm-hmm.
The effectual
Jesus.
Prayer of a righteous man avails much.
All right. Confess your faults one to another.
Yes.
Now the system says, Doc, you better not tell nobody that.
Come on, Doc. Come on.
Now, you better not tell nobody what's going on with you. Amen. You better not tell nobody that you got a problem because they won't want to hear you preach no more.
Yes.
You better not tell nobody that you're dealing with something because they won't think that you're what they thought you were. You won't be the mighty apostle. But you got to come to the place where I don't care about this stuff.
That's
I want to get right.
Because
this stuff is killing me.
Jesus.
Confess your faults one to another. I ought to be able to tell you what's going on with me and not have you jump on the phone and before I leave your house, my business is all over the street.
Because
one of the reasons we have so much trouble with that is because we got a city full of preachers that can't hold water.
All right.
You scared to tell your pastor what's really going on with you.
You know,
not because he might take you down from ministry, but because you think you know he's going to tell everybody else.
My God.
I'm sorry. Nobody's going to like me. One of the greatest contributing factors to the weakness of the church is the fact that we're sometimes more interested in how things look than how they really are, especially black folks.
Yeah.
I think it's something that roots from slavery. Amen. We got this syndrome where you can have a Mercedes Benz sitting outside the house, and I come in the house, you got the couch up on blocks.
Yeah.
Hey, Jabo, can I get a sandwich, man? We ain't got
in the fridge,
but you got that Benz.
Got that Benz.
Ain't that how we do? Amen. We got to wear everybody else's name on our butt.
Yeah.
And he got a dime.
My God.
Because we are more interested in how things look than how they really are, especially in church.
All right.
Our church culture trains men to be phony.
Yeah.
And then it discards them when they're caught being phony.
Yes.
Am I saying something?
Santa. Yes, sir.
The one thing that we as men have to do is learn to be honest, not only with God, but with one another about our struggles so that we can help each other to overcome.
Amen.
Look at somebody, if you will, and say, brother, drag it into the light. Look at somebody else and say, brother, if you really want to get free from that thing, you got to drag it into the light. Now give God a hand of praise. Drag it into the light.
Yes. Go ahead. Go ahead. Help yourself.
We got to understand that the men are the eyes of the church.
That's what it says.
One of the greatest areas in our lives that the devil seems to deal with men is in the area of our eyes.
Literally.
We have to understand that men are sight-oriented anyway.
Yes.
Amen, amen. On Valentine's Day, I'm pretty sure there were many wives who wanted to come home and they wanted to cuddle with their husbands. I said husbands.
Yeah.
That's right. Amen.
Not boyfriend.
Not boyfriend.
They wanted to cuddle with their husbands and they wanted to watch a movie and they wanted to romanticize and fantasize. Am I right about that?
Yeah.
Yeah. Amen. More than likely the man came home with a box and when he opened up the box he said, baby, put this on. Because he wanted to see something. Because that's how we are. God made us sight-oriented. But when sin came in, the first place the devil began to operate is the place where God made us the strongest, because he understood that if he puts out our eyes, the church will lose direction. And that's why we don't know where we're going.
All right.
Moses began to beg his father-in-law, will you please come with us into the promised land and be our eyes?
Yes.
Because you know where the rough stuff is. You know where the bad parts are. You know where the wild animals are. So we cannot go if you don't come with us.
Amen.
And if you look in the Bible, you'll find that Moses' father-in-law was black.
Come on.
To the black man.
Uh-huh.
Man, I'm going with my folks.
Oh, yeah.
I ain't studying y'all.
All right.
Y'all go that way, we go this way.
Uh-huh.
Amen. And we're still carrying out that same agenda today, but God wants to use us to be able to see the road, see the way for the church, and begin to look back and speak a word that'll bring us into what God is destined for us, but for the foundation of the world. Somebody look at somebody and say, the sisters are waiting on you. We are the eyes of the church. We got to understand that, again, the devil deals with us through our eyes. Two of the areas that the enemy has dealt with me the most strongly has been my eyes and my mouth. If he can get you looking at the wrong stuff, and if he can get you saying the wrong things out of your mouth, you have lost all power to become the man that God has.
Come on.
You think you get it by going to the gym?
Tell me about it.
You get it by speaking those things which be not as though they were. You get it by fixing your eyes on Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. We get it by sanctifying our eyes. That's why Job said, I made a covenant with my eyes that I would not look lustfully upon a woman. God made us to love the beauty of a woman. But when sin came into the world, it turned into lust. Now you just can't help myself.
Tell it, Doc.
But we have to drag that thing into the light.
Amen.
We have to drag it into the light because we have to understand that as long as a thing remains in the dark, it continues to have power over you. Good God Almighty. The Bible says in John, the first chapter, that the light came into the world.
Yes, it did.
And the darkness comprehended it not. In other words, the darkness did not know what light was.
No, it didn't.
The darkness could not handle light. It could not oppose light. It could not stand against light. It could not understand light. And whenever darkness encounters light, darkness has to flee. It's got to go. It's got
to go.
And so we have so many men sitting in the darkness, suffering and crying, weeping and wailing and crying out to God for deliverance, but you won't tell nobody. You got to understand that I got 2 computer degrees. And I fix people's computers. Huh?
Tell it, Doc.
And do you know how many brothers have looked at me and said, no, man, that ain't my problem. That ain't it, Doc. Then I look into your computer and I see you been to hotgirls.com. But it's not that he's dealing with, it's just that he's dealing with something that he really doesn't feel he can talk about. He feels like if he talks about that pain, they're going to kick him to the curb, they're going to push him in a corner, they're going to ostracize him, they're going to beat him down, they're going to treat him, I thought you said you were saved. And that's exactly what we do. And that's why we're all in our corners of darkness, suffering the way we are, because we can't tell nobody. Germany.
Tell it, Doc. I hear you.
Looked me dead in the face, Pastor.
Yes, sir.
I said, man, I'm going to help you with this thing. You and me, we're going to get together. I'm going to be on you like white on rice. And when I started feeling some hope, oh, man, we're going to do this. Finally, we're going to do this.
Amen.
Man, when I went to church, folks were looking at me like I had the bad disease. And he never did call me. He never did anything to help me. All he did is he went and told folks about it. But we got to come to the place where we can keep a secret. We got to come to the place where we can be accountable one to another. We got to come to the place where we can help a brother struggling, be able to walk up to a brother and say, how you doing with that thing today?
Amen.
And get an honest answer.
Amen.
Yes.
Because he knows he can trust me. Am I saying something? You gotta understand that it was not the Philistines that killed Samson. I know we think that Delilah killed Samson. But if you look at the book of Judges in 14 and 1 and in 16 and 1, the first thing you see about Samson that's common about those two verses is that he saw. And it was what Samson saw that killed him. It was not the swords of the Philistine. It was not the wiles of Delilah. It was what he saw. And every time he saw something, he wanted it. And every time he saw something, he was diverted from his God-given mission. And each time he saw something and started messing around. See, the part about it is that you can see a thing and you go after that thing and then you come back after you have gone after what you have gone after and you come back up here and it works.
It's your
dude. That's a dangerous part.
Yeah.
And then you go out there and you fool around a little bit more.
Yeah.
The first time he went to the vineyard, he was not supposed to touch wine. He was not supposed to touch alcoholic drink.
Yeah.
Amen. He went over there messing around in that vineyard.
All right.
Come on now. What?
Then he was not supposed to touch a dead body.
I know it did.
And he ran over here and started messing with a dead lion. But each time he came back, he swung the jawbone of an ass and killed 1,000 Philistines.
Yeah.
Then he came back and he set fire to the foxes' tails and ran them through the camp of the Philistines. And his heart was saying, I really don't want to do this thing. But it works. And many of us think that we can continue in what it is that we've been doing. We can keep on laying up in the darkness and we'll keep on coming back. And each time we come back, God is going to anoint us. But there came a day when they had him tied up. They had him jacked up. They had him messed up. And he flexed his arms. And he said, I'm going to do the same thing I always do. I'll get the microphone. I'll jump in the pulpit. And I'll say, say yeah. Say yeah. And the folk will shout like they always do. The folk will dance like they always do. They'll get delivered like they always do. But this time, was not that the anointing was gone.
Yes.
And sometime in that dark place, you got to cry out to God. Lord, stop me before I destroy everything I have. Lord, help me before I blow it off. Lord, don't let me go back there again. Help me, Lord, because it's me. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Statistics for you. Statistics. Pornography.
Tell
it. You're talking about sexual temptation. See, we don't mind talking about glory in them. We'll talk about Mabel in them.
Yeah.
Because you can see Mabel. Ain't the one had the red dress on? Oh, that was Lucy. We talk about that. But we don't always talk about the jacket.
Yeah.
We don't always talk about the things that we got stuffed up under the bed.
Yeah.
We don't always talk about the things that some of us, we got it so bad. We come home like Ricky Ricardo. Was it Ricky Ricardo? Come home and say, honey, I'm home. Walk past the wife and go to the computer.
Never do.
There's a whole lot of things I thought I'd never do. I grew up in the 60s and it was talking about marijuana.
Yes.
And I was 6 years old, I was scared, but the commercials just come on, marijuana. Oh man, marijuana gonna get you. I've never messed with that stuff.
Yes.
When I was about 10, I was sitting across the table from a gentleman by the name of Mr. Horace. You know, they always be named Horace, right?
Yeah.
And he had a bottle of wine.
Uh-huh.
And he looked at me, it was almost prophetic.
Yeah.
He said, he took that bottle of wine, and he looked at me, and he said, don't drink this, or you'll be like this. That man knew where I was going.
Yeah.
He knew where I was going.
Uh-huh.
He was trying to save me from destruction. And like a little boy, I think I know everything. Yeah. Oh man, I ain't gonna let me act. You ain't gotta worry about me. No, you don't know.
All right.
All you need is some money and some opportunity.
Yeah.
And don't mess around and get to Europe.
Yeah.
Or Korea somewhere. And the Marines are willing to cut you loose with a whole bunch of money. Honey, you ain't sitting in no barracks reading your Bible.
Uh-huh.
I tried that.
Tell it about.
Didn't work. 17%, no. 51% of all ministers admitted to viewing pornography and admitted to having a struggle in this area. 17% of women.
Uh-huh.
I know y'all thought it was just us.
Uh-huh.
I don't know what it is y'all trying to see. What I think y'all be looking at is probably gonna look good to me. But lust ain't no joke, man.
No, it's not.
And it'll talk to you, it'll talk to anybody.
Anybody.
Yeah. Devil don't care about your title.
No, it don't.
I'm gonna be honest, when I first walked in here.
Tell it, Doc.
When I first walked in here.
That's right.
Yo said,
you do that.
Pastor Fine.
Yeah.
Might as well tell the truth.
Hey, tell it that you're set free. Tell it that you're
here. And it's not about what the devil says to you.
Yes.
Because you can go all your same life thinking he gonna stop talking to you, but you have control.
Yes, man. Yes, man.
You have control.
You got it. Yes.
But as many as received him, and them gave he power to become the sons of God.
Yes.
Go home to your wife.
Yes.
But there's probably been about 1,000 of them come through here like that. Yeah, they have. Agendas.
Yeah.
Cast that demon right on out. I see you, devil.
Yeah.
How many of you have the ball doing it too?
Yeah.
Amen.
I remember I was sitting in the pool with this watcher, man. And this lady, what was her name? Golden Lewis came in, and she's a nice looking lady. And I could tell that she had been in a situation where folk had just, you know, she could, like, I can't even walk in a church. Mm-hmm. I can't even walk in a church, but I'm some joker.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, and we sitting in the pulpit, and that preacher gonna say something. She pulled a prayer, her left arm, and the preacher gonna say something like, yeah, that's right, cover up them legs. That's why I gotta teach ministry lessons.
Yeah. That's right.
Yo, where did you get that foolishness from?
Yeah.
That's why we got to train ministers.
Amen.
We have to learn how to act. We have to represent our profession. I don't care what you seek.
That's right.
God, give me some control over myself.
Amen.
Don't let me walk around like a rabid dog, you know, can't control nothing. Yeah. Keep my eyes off anybody. Gotta wag my wife and everybody else's too. Something. The devil likes it when we're phony because he knows that as long as a thing remains in the darkness, and you got to understand, like I said, the pornography is addictive, it's highly addictive, and it thrives on darkness. And as long as you keep it in the dark, it'll continue to have power over you. And the light shines in darkness, and darkness comprehended it now.
Can you do it no
more?
Three good reasons to drag it into the light, and then I'm done. First of all, it's not worth it. It ain't worth it.
No.
don't care how good that stuff is.
Uh-huh.
I don't care how good that stuff looks.
Yes.
It's destroying you.
Yes.
Proverbs 6:26. For by means of a whorish woman, a man is brought to a piece of bread.
Oh, yeah. All right.
And that means more than just being broke down to the point where all you have is a piece of bread.
Uh-huh.
You got to understand that bread was the most common staple diet in the ancient world. Everybody had bread. Bread was everywhere.
Yes.
Amen. You might not be able to find some gold, but bread was not rare. In other words, it was common. In other words, by means of a whorish woman, you can be brought down to the level of down from where God has placed you, from your sonship, from your kingship, from your purpose, from your power, from your destiny, to just some old dude walking down the street.
That's right.
It'll make you common.
Right.
You think you got away with something when you slept with Lucy.
Uh-huh.
But you're common now. You're just like everybody else. There's nothing special about you. There's nothing anointed about you. There's nothing about you that shines because you've been brought down to a piece of bread. And that's what Samson said. He said to Delilah, if I break my vow with God, I'll become just like any other man. And I don't know about you, but I don't just want to be some old dude. I don't want to just be some old guy. I don't want to be one of the cats. I want to be a warrior. You got to understand that if you keep seeing pigeons, it's because you're flying too low. God made you to lift up with wings as an eagle. God made you to run and God not be weary. God made you to walk and not faint. Say
yeah.
In his message, detours to destiny. T.D. Jakes mentions, am I doing all right here? T.D. Jakes mentions five consequences of a detour. And he's using Samson as a backdrop. This is from Judges 16:21. First of all, the Bible says that the Philistines took him. Anybody ever been took?
Yes.
How many of us have been in the back of a police car?
Yes.
That's what they do when they put them cuffs on you. They take you. In other words, he lost control. And one of the worst things that a man can do outside of the presence of God is lose control. I no longer have control of my finances. I'm no longer the head of my house. I no longer have control when I go on the job because I've messed up so bad that anybody and everybody can just push me around. Samson lost control. And then the second thing, they put out his eyes.
All right.
He lost his vision. The worst thing in the world to be is a man that has no vision. Ladies, I don't care how good he look. If he ain't got no vision, you don't need him. He can be 6 feet tall, look like Billy D. Williams, got big muscles and curly hair. But if he ain't got no vision, he ain't going nowhere. I notice that a lot of men, we get hooked up with educated women. We get hooked up with women who are professional. We get hooked up with women that got it going on. Slap them around and beat them up. It's not their fault that you don't have no vision. It's not their fault that you're not going anywhere. And then the third thing.
Go ahead.
They brought him down.
Brought him down.
You got to understand that the name Delilah roots from the word Delilah, which means to be brought down. With stuff that only brings us down. It might feel good, but it only brings us down. You might have the best brand in the land, but it's only gonna bring you down. She might look real good in that skirt, but she's only gonna bring you down. He lost his position. Did he used to be a deacon? Look at that brother down there, staggering down the street. Used to be one of the baddest preachers in the city. I remember when I first came to America after living in Germany for almost 20 years. I was sitting in a car with my brother, and a man walked across our path. He was pushing a shopping cart, and I clearly, distinctly heard the devil say, "That's what I'm gonna do to you." But I come to tell you that the devil is a liar. For the last 20 years, he's trying to give me that shopping cart. He's trying to give me that junkie life. to serve the Lord. I'm still got a mind to give him praise. I'm still got a mind to do his will. Say yeah. Say yeah. And then they bound him with fetters.
Yes.
They tied him up. They bound him up. In other words, he lost his mobility. You can't go where you want to go because you got to go to rehab. You can't do what you want to do because you got to be the group at 1 o'clock. You can't get involved in nothing substantial because you got to report to your probation officer because the devil has tied you up. The devil has bound you up. That's what happens when you get on a detour road. That's what happens when you start messing with stuff like pornography. It'll tie you up. In other words, he lost his status. Samson was the great judge of Israel. He judged Israel for 20 years. He sat in a big chair and he pronounced judgment over people. And now the mighty man of God finds himself going around and around. How many of us have been going around and around just grinding at the mill? I'm ready to come out of being broke. I'm ready to come out of not having it. I'm ready to come out of looking the part and not really having the goods. I'm ready to come out of having a title and not really having the power. If I'm the apostle in the church, I ought to be the apostle on my job. If I'm the apostle in the church, I ought to be the apostle at the bank. You got to understand that power. Away sad, we walk away broken because somebody said no. But real power is being able to walk into the office and have them say yes. You can have the loan. Yes, pastor. You can have the building. Yeah, I can have whatever God says I can have. Second reason, second reason to drag it into the light is because you can't do it alone. You can't do it by yourself. I know the devil is telling you you're strong. He's telling you that you're able to bear this thing all by yourself. I got this, man. I'm a man. But you won't humble yourself. But sometimes you got to fall on your brother's shoulder and say, I need some help with this thing. For if they fall, one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him that is alone when he falleth. I don't know about you. Have you ever been alone when you fell? Have you ever been alone when you fail? Nobody to pick you up. Nobody to say keep a moment. Nobody to tell you it's going to be all right. That's a miserable place to be. You don't understand. I used to go to the nastiest, ugliest, cockroaches, filthiest hotel in the city. Locked myself up in a room just to indulge my flesh, and there was nobody to come in there but Jesus. There was nobody to come in there but the Lord. But I come to tell you on today, you don't have to fight all by yourself. To drag it into the light is because God has something better for us. Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, thoughts of good and not of evil, to bring you to an expected end. I got an expected end for you. It doesn't matter how many times you trip on the way. It doesn't matter how many times you fell down. It doesn't matter how many times the devil told you that you wasn't going to make it. But I've lost a lot of years. I might not look that old, but I'm older than you think. And most of those years, I've spent indulging foolishness. But I thank God that He's the God of another chance. I thank God that the end of the thing is better than the beginning. Say it. Say it. Job 25:26. And I will restore to you. The years that the locusts have eaten, the cankerworm and the caterpillar, the palmer worm, my great army, which I sent among you, God said, I sent. In other words, He's not tempted with evil, neither does He tempt any man with evil, but He'll take that thing. Listen, man, I didn't have nothing but a high school GED. I got 2 computer degrees. And that same thing, listen, man, there was times when I would sit at the computer and I would see a picture of Fifi LeBeau. I know your real name was made up. And I say, I'm going to get every single picture of Fifi. I'm going to find Fifi. And I would sit there all night long. And I would click and click and click and click and click and click until I found, you got to understand that every man is a hunter. What salvation does is it redirects your energies. It turns you from hunting all the wrong stuff to get to hunt, to hunting the good stuff that God has for you. And he said that same perseverance, that same stick-to-itiveness, I'm going to use that same ability to focus on a thing and go after what you want to win souls. You used to hunt pigeons of dirty, nasty women. Souls, say it, say it. God wants to give you back everything that you lost. He wants to give you back your pride. He wants to give you back your purpose. He wants to give you back your prosperity. I'm almost done, but I want you to know that I know what I'm talking about. When I was 15 years old,
Jesus.
Somebody 15 now need to hear this.
Yeah.
When I was 15 years old.
Tell it.
Mr. Butler, make sure you get it.
Tell it.
When I was 15 years old, my father had this big cabinet.
Uh-huh.
He'll put clothes in, so he was like you know, he kept his clothes up and everything.
Yeah.
There's a reason why the Bible says, children, obey your parents.
Yes, yes.
Goes right in the sight of the Lord because He's trying to protect you.
Yes.
You think you know everything.
Yeah.
My father said, Ramon, my father said, stay out of my cabinet.
Uh-huh.
You got to understand that some of us are fighting our daddy's devil.
Yeah.
And even your stuff.
Tell it, Doc.
And in order for you to walk in victory, you got to do what Gideon had to do.
Yeah.
Amen. God told Gideon, in order for you to go against the Midianites, there's one thing you got to do. You got to tear down the idol that your father had built up. And it was an idol, a statue of a bull. And I want every man in this place to look at every other man and say, brother, you got to kill your father's bull.
That's the word.
Because that's what that is. That's his bull. You think that's your attitude. That's his attitude. All your life they were talking to you, you look just like your daddy. You know you beat just like your daddy. You know you drunk just like your daddy. Daddy been in the grave. the one reason you got to be free from this thing is because if you don't get that thing out of your house, it's going to get on your children. Let me tell you something. One day I was sitting at the computer. I had the computer turned this way. And my little girl, I thought she couldn't see me. Now it's a horrible thing for a three-year-old little girl to walk up and say, "No more pictures, Daddy."
Oh, my God.
But that wasn't enough to make me stop. Because when my father told me, "Stay out of my cabinet.
Stay out of my
cabinet." I got a screwdriver.
Yeah.
Because the law is like that. If the law says 65, you gotta go 50. If the law says 55, you gotta go 60.
Yeah.
That's how the law do. That's why when you tell the children, stay away from them cookies.
Yeah.
Amen. They're going in there.
Yeah.
Because that's what the law does. It activates sin. I was fine until he said, stay away from the cabinet.
Yeah.
I got a screwdriver and I went into the cabinet. And guess what I found? If you don't obey your parents, you can open up a Pandora's box that'll still be open and you 50 something years old, still dealing with what you did that daddy told you not to do.
Yeah. You know you're right.
Am I saying something in here?
Yeah.
I want somebody to get free. They might look at the video and say, we have to defrock him. We have to come to the house and take his papers. We have to shut down his ministry because he had that problem. But I'm going to say it today because I want you to know that that thing that you're looking at on your phone is going to kill you.
Hey, hey.
Since I was 15 years old, you want to talk about bondage?
Yeah.
Buying the magazine.
Uh-huh.
Throw the magazine away.
Yeah.
Go back to the store, buy the same magazine.
Yeah.
Go in the climbing in the dumpster to get the magazine. I was on one job. That was the most miserable time in my life. I walked out of that job every day feeling so unclean. So unclean because I said I was good at my job. And not this last one. Okay? Oh, wow. You know, when we had a lot of leeway, we could have our own office. And I was sitting there and I would click and click and click and click. And you know what? As I finished clicking, I would delete that job.
Uh-huh.
I didn't even want it.
Tell it.
But a man is a hunter.
Yes, he is.
That's why he go to bed with some of y'all and the next morning he wake up and he wants you to leave. Because it's not about having it, it's about getting it.
My God.
You know that's right.
It's about the going after of it.
Yeah, right.
But God said, I'm going to train you to hunt something else.
Amen.
I was reading last night about a young lady. Her name was Chrissy. I think her real name is Christina.
Uh-huh.
That young lady is married and in the ministry.
Uh-huh.
With her husband. Beautiful ministry.
Yes.
But she used to be one of my favorite girls.
All right.
Yes, sir. Mighty woman of God now.
Look out.
But you know, the day I found out she got saved,
uh-huh,
I had a dream and then I dreamed I was raping my sister.
Yeah.
You got to understand that those... God changed my eyes.
Yeah.
So that when I look at him,
uh-huh,
I might see a naked body, but I also see a soul.
Yes,
in need of salvation.
Yes,
and you know the one thing about being hooked up in that stuff is every time one of them got saved.
Yeah.
Every time one of them got saved, I got a video of one of them getting baptized, filled with the Holy Ghost.
Filled with the Holy Ghost.
I cry so hard. Because that's what it's really all about. God taking broken, busted up people. You can't believe what a nasty, filthy industry that is. But God even reaches down into that and raises up soldiers for his glory. Raises up citizens of his kingdom. Good God Almighty. And there were times, even after I found out she got saved, I wanted to go back and look at Chrissy. But the Holy Ghost said, that's your sister. What's wrong with you? You don't be looking at your sister. Have you lost your mind? Those are your sisters. You need to be praying for them. You ought to be in the seed for them. And I'll be done.
Tell it, Doctor.
Every man is a worshiper. God made us to worship.
Amen.
That's why he gave you this gift. That's why he gave you this gift. You got to understand, if you don't worship God, you're going to worship something. The man who walks all the way across town in a snowstorm just to get a drink. He's worshiping his God. The man who can't sleep with his own wife. Got to have everybody else's wife. He's worshiping his God. But I was made to worship no one but him. I want to ask everybody, every man to stand on his feet.
That's what he said.
And I don't know if this was about you today, but I bet you I said something that touched on right where you are. I know I parked in somebody's driveway. I know I went up in somebody's yard. But if we don't do anything today, we need to consecrate our eyes.
Amen.
My eyes belong to God. We have some closing music. My eyes. Every man say, my eyes belong to God. My eyes are made for holy things.
Made for holy things.
Father, in the name of Jesus, from this day forward, we consecrate our eyes to you.
You know that?
I don't want to call nobody out.
Yes.
But you know where you are.
Yes.
You know where you are in that struggle.
All right.
And if you ever find yourself again, and you will. See, because I thought that God was just going to zap me into righteousness.
My God.
That if I cried hard enough, that if I went to church enough times, that if I preached hard enough, that it'll never come upon me again. Something that you gotta fight for.
Yeah.
This is a battle, the battle of a man. This is something that you might have to barricade yourself in the room and sweat all night until you get free. God says, I'm not gonna give it to you, because if I just give it to you, you won't appreciate it. Partaker of the fruits, Lord.
Jesus.
In the name of Jesus. You may be seated. I want to share some final statistics with you. You can keep playing. The revenue from pornography is larger than all combined revenues of all professional football, baseball, and basketball franchises. That's a lot of money spent on some mess. Child pornography generates $3 billion annually. And if you're looking at somebody's kids, you really need your behind beat. U.S. porn revenue, y'all keep playing, exceeds the combined revenues, I know y'all want to hear this, of ABC, CBS, and NBC. That's $6.2 billion. When we view, purchase, and partake of pornography, we are contributing to the propagation of an evil, wicked system that destroys both men and women, and eventually will cause us to miss the purpose for which God has created us,
Jesus,
and separate us eventually from Him eternally. Won't you repent with me today? Drag your secret sin into the light, whatever it is, where it will never have power over you again. And here's a final promise. I love this. Job 11, listen to this while the music plays. Because you got to put music behind this. This is beautiful. Take this to heart, man. Job 11, 13 through 19. If thou prepare thine heart and stretch out thine hands toward him, if iniquity be in thine hand, put it far away. And let not wickedness dwell in thine tabernacles. For then thou shalt lift up thy face without spot. Yea, thou shalt be steadfast and shall not fear. Because thou shalt forget thy misery. And in all those long nights will become a distant memory. And remember it as waters that pass away. And thine age shall be clearer than the noonday. And thou shalt shine forth. Thou shalt be as the morning. And thou shalt be secure. Won't nobody be able to take your stuff anymore. Because there is hope. Yea, thou shalt dig about thee. And thou shalt take thy rest in safety. And thou shalt lie down. And none shall make thee afraid. Yea, many shall make suit unto thee. Give God a hand of praise.